Hey, audio geeks. I'm going to share with you some of the work I've been doing to unofficially integrate Smart Data Modeler with my DBX drive rack. I'll show you how, with a single command, you can apply processing from Data Modeler to the drive rack, and in this case, it's a drive rack PA2. So I'll start with a brief demo. Here we have a mostly unconfigured drive rack with a high, mid, and a low band. There's no delays, there's no parametric EQs, and the crossover is a pretty stock setting that does effectively nothing. Here in Data Modeler, I did some processing on the three bands and exported that. Now I'm going to issue a command. And as you can see, the crossover points were set. My parametric EQ was also transferred, and my alignment delays were set. Now, if this is something that's of interest to you, keep watching, and I'll show you how it's done and how you can do it yourself. So first, why did I do this and why might you want to? Well, the drive rack PA2 seems to be pretty ubiquitous these days, at least in the middle market of pro audio and live sound. I own one myself. It's affordable, pretty easy to use, and offers a lot of features for dialing in a small to medium-sized PA system. Now you might say, the drive rack has a wizard and it'll guide you through setting up a lot of aspects of the system using a measurement mic. And to be fair, it's not all that bad. But while the drive rack will do some tonal shaping in terms of EQ and help you set levels of different speaker bands, it certainly won't do a ton in terms of helping you make an informed decision about crossover topology, setting your high and low pass filters, or selecting how much delay to add to each band to get optimal summation. So many of us turn to a dedicated audio analyzer for this purpose. There's a lot of great ones out there. I happen to be a Smart user, and not too long ago they released Data Modeler, which allows you to predictably explore offline the effects of filters and other DSP processing on measurements. I've been finding this to be a great tool when I can't sit in front of a PA for half an hour, maybe with patrons in the room blasting pink noise and soloing bands on the PA while I try things out. However, once I have a set of filters in Data Modeler that I want to try, then comes the tedious process of transferring these one by one to the drive rack. In a lot of cases, the units, like on high and low shelves, don't even match up to the slope values that are on the drive rack. Now, Rational Acoustics, the makers of Smart and Smart Data Modeler, in partnership with Eclipse Audio, have stated that Data Modeler will be able to connect to select devices and transfer settings, although right now that's still a future feature. However, given the manufacturers currently listed in the software, I don't expect there to be too much manufacturer interest in an official integration in my situation, so I went about bridging this gap myself. If you want to know more about how I achieved this, you can browse the two open source projects that I created in the process on GitHub. But this video is going to focus more on how to use them in a practical way. So first off, this is a command line program. But even if you're not that kind of techno geek, don't worry, I think it's pretty simple, and dare I say, at times even borderline user-friendly. So let's dive in. Now this should work on almost any computer platform, whether you have Mac, Windows, Linux. This is all run using the Python language, so there's a pretty good chance you're covered. You'll need at least Python version 3.11. I'm not going to cover installing Python here, so if you don't know how to do that, please Google it. It's also very much recommended to install Python modules like this one in a Python virtual environment. But to keep this video focused, I'm not going to cover that either, so please read about that if you care enough. One more thing, I am going to mention that I only own the drive rack PA2. As much as I'd love to offer support for the other models like the Venue 360, I don't have one to test with. So unless you have a means of helping me develop support for one, please don't flood the comments asking me to add it. So let's start in Smart Data Modeler. If you're watching this, you hopefully have, or at least have tried a copy of it, and know the basics of how it works. As you'll know, in Data Modeler, you create DSP channels, and you apply filters to each one of them. And in this case, each DSP channel block is analogous to one of the three output bands that the drive rack is capable of, high, mid, and low. Now, when you run the converter program, it'll allow you to map or associate up to three of these bands to the processing bands on the drive rack, the high, mid, and low bands. Now, when you start a new project in Data Modeler, You'll have the option to pick a compatible DSP. Clearly, at this time, it knows nothing about the drive rack, so we'll choose generic. Now you can choose either bandwidth or queue. It doesn't matter. The converter will make those conversions for you. Now, because we chose generic, we'll have to be mindful of which filters you use. Only the ones supported by the drive rack will be converted, and all the others will be ignored. Polarity, level, and delay will all be supported, obviously, as well. And you can set up to 8 filters per band, any combination of the parametrics or the high and low shelves. Now be mindful of the Q values you use. These need to be in range as well, or they'll be rejected. If you want to see exactly how high and low you can go, check the website for the converter, and I list this information here. Now, if you've used the drive rack, you know that each band requires a high and a low pass filter. You can't turn this off. So in Data Modeler, you can also add up to 1 high pass and low pass filter, either Butterworth or Linkwitz-Riley, to each band. If you don't, a first order Butterworth filter at 6 dB per octave at the minimum or maximum frequencies will be chosen automatically for minimal impact. Now let's say in Data Modeler we just finished an alignment and a tuning, and we're ready to try it out on the drive rack. Well, Eclipse Audio did a great thing, and they created a file format called LPIF. That's Loudspeaker Processor Interchange Format. And in Data Modeler, you can export your current project as an LPIF file. So export it, and we'll be back to that in a little bit. So let's start by installing the converter app. Again, make sure you have Python at least version 3.11 installed, and I also strongly suggest you use a Python virtual environment. Google it. If you're on a Mac, open a terminal window. On Windows, command prompt. If you're on Linux, well, you're probably bored and waiting for me to get to the point here. The converter app itself is called LPIF2, number 2, DBX drive rack. Yeah, I know it's kind of a long name. Sorry. So in our terminal, we're going to type pip install LPIF2 DBX drive rack. This will download it from the internet, and we're done. Now, and from now on, you can simply type LPIF2 DBX drive rack space and the file name that you exported from Data Modeler. Now, in most terminals, you can simply drag and drop the name of a file, and it'll automatically type out the full path to it. When you press Enter, the converter will scan for any online drive rack devices and display a list of them available. Now, these interactive dialogs do support mouse clicks, so you don't have to mess around with the arrow keys, the tab keys, and the space keys to navigate. And when you connect to a drive rack, it'll determine how many bands are active, of the high, mids, or lows. And then it'll give you the opportunity to designate and map each DSP processing block from Data Modeler to one of these bands. In my case, I want to map the top high frequency bands to the high band of the drive rack. I want the low frequency drivers mapped to the mid band. And finally, I want my subs mapped to the low band. Let me make this window transparent so you can see the control app behind it. When I hit continue, the first thing it's going to do is momentarily mute all the outputs of the drive rack, apply the processing, and then return the mutes to where they were. So that's the most basic usage, and you can feel free to stop here and go try it out yourself. However, there are several options you can specify that make this program more useful for your workflows. If you run the converter with dash dash help, you'll get a full list of all the available options. You can also go to the GitHub page for a full description of each one. The first option I'm going to focus on now is the Connect Single option. Now, most of the time, you probably only have one drive rack available on the network that you're looking to manage. If you specify Connect Single, it'll select the first and only one it finds without prompting you. Next is the address option. If you know the IP address of the drive rack you want to connect to and want to skip the discovery process, you can specify it right here. It'll skip the process and connect right away. This also allows you to connect to a dry rack that's on a different network subnet that's not available via discovery. I pointed out in the last example that all of the outputs were automatically muted before changes were applied, and this is to prevent any weird noises or even feedback that might occur during changes. If you don't like this behavior, you can specify no muted as an option. Now, when you're applying DSP processing blocks to the output bands of the drive rack, you may have noticed that there's an option to skip and do no processing on a particular band. In this case, I might want to leave the high band alone, so I can say no band processing and maybe only apply the mids and the lows. Now, normally, when you do this, it'll apply the mid and lows and leave the high band untouched. But this may be not always the desired behavior. Sometimes you might want to apply the band you selected and then reset the other one so that they don't have any effect on the system. You can do this with the reset unmapped option. I'll add that to our previous command and see what happens. Select no band processing for the high. Select our mid and lows. And in this case, it took our parametric EQ and delays and even our crossover band and effectively made them inactive. Now, there may be times when you don't want your crossover high and low pass filters changed, or you want to keep the delays set. Here you have the ability to disable certain drive rack blocks when you use the converter. If you want to keep your delays as they are, specify no delay. Same with parametric EQs, no PEQ. And if you don't want to touch the crossover block, no crossover. The crossover block also includes any gain or polarity changes you make. Now, sometimes you just love your system setup, but you only want to apply some tonal EQ to the whole thing. The drive rack's auto EQ section using the manual mode allows you to do this. So in Data Modeler, here I have a single measurement that I just applied some EQ filters to and exported that as an LPIF file. If I specify my file and run the command with room EQ, you can see that it changed the manual settings to match my filters. You'll notice there was no prompting, and that's because there was only one DSP processing block in the file I used. If I go back and use the three band option that I had before with room EQ, I'll be given the option to map the room EQ to only one of those three bands. In this case, let me choose the sub block and see what happens. In here, you can see it applied the single band that I previously used on the subs to the room EQ. Now, one last thing. If anyone from Rational Acoustics or Eclipse Audio happens to be watching, this tool can operate with an LPIF pipe to it using standard input. Consider adding an advanced option to Data Modeler that'll allow us to specify a custom script to send LPIF data to within the application for an unsupported device integration. And if it's at all possible, consider opening up a file specification for end users to define compatible impulse response filters that can be imported into Data Modeler. Now, while we all hope and wish that manufacturers of loudspeaker processors will do this for us, the prosumer market that some of us find ourselves in probably aren't going to be interested in the investment. So there's an overview of what I've done so far. I'm always interested in feedback, so please feel free to get in touch.